The most important thing I learned from my time working on Sea of Thieves is that planning is key. Without it, our workflow would have been a hot mess of discouraging disaster. We're all looking at you, Blizzard. So learning from this, let's go through what we'll be doing during our time together. First, we'll go over the design of our effect, and I'll walk you through every step you need to take in order to create your own shiny runes, teaching foundational Niagara concepts along the way. If you're a beginner, this is a great place to start. Then in part 2, I'll show you how to customize your effect on a per instance basis directly from blueprints. And finally in part 3, we'll learn how to use Niagara's definitely not buggy debugging tools to analyze the performance of our runes. So without further ado, let's get into the action. As with all great effects, our rune is made up of multiple stages, each transitioning to the next seamlessly. First, we have the build-up stage, in which the rune on the ground fades into the player's view over 1 second. When this is done, our effect transitions into its active stage. This is the time in which our effect comes to life, showing off all its shiny glory. This stage is made up of 4 simultaneous sub-effects: the rune on the ground, the flame-like particles surrounding the rune, and the 2 different types of floating particles. After 11 seconds, this stage ends, with our effect transitioning into its dissipation stage. The dissipation stage is composed of the rune on the ground fading out over 1 second, leaving the floating and surrounding particles to fade out over the following second. You can get all the assets you'll need to create this rune from the link in the description, but be careful when you're down there, you don't want to accidentally hit that sub button. The only assumption we're making is that everyone here knows what Niagara systems and emitters are. If you don't, check out this video teaching you everything you need to know in 300 seconds, and then come back here. Now for the fun part. We'll start by creating the Niagara system to house our rune. In your content browser, right-click and select Niagara system. Create an empty system and name it ns_runeofpower. Then double-click this asset to open up the Niagara system editor. The first thing we'll do is go to the Windows toolbar and select the Preview Scene Settings option. Now open up the Environment section, disable Show Environment and Show Floor, then set the environment color to black. This way we can better visualize what's happening inside of our effect. Now that we have our system, we create the emitter which will produce our rune effect. To do this, right-click anywhere in the system overview window, select Add Emitter, and then press Empty Emitter. Select this new emitter, then press F2 to rename it. Give it a name like ne_ground_rune. Before we do anything else, we want to make sure that our effect is active for the amount of time that we desire. We also want to be able to change this value on a per instance basis, as this will empower us to do a lot more with it in the future. To do this, press the plus button in the User Exposed section of the Parameters panel, and search for Float. Name this parameter Effect Runtime. Now select the blue system node and set this parameter's default value to 14. Then press the drop-down arrow to the right of the loop duration attribute in the system state module and search and select for this effect runtime parameter. Now select the initialize particle module for the ground rune emitter we just made and drag the effect runtime parameter into its lifetime attribute. As we want our rune on the ground to be facing upwards, we need to delete the sprite renderer that is currently set and then add a mesh renderer. Now with the mesh renderer selected, open up the meshes array and set the mesh in index 0 to be the plain mesh that comes with the engine. Then enable the override materials option and press the plus button to add a material instance to this array. This is where we're going to add our material containing our rune texture. To create our new material, right click in your materials directory and select material. Name it m_add_ss_niagara. M for material, add for additive, and ss because it'll be a single sided material, as we'll only ever need to see one side of our rune. Double click this asset to open up the material editor. Select your master node, then in the details panel, set the blend mode to be additive, set the shading model to be unlit, and make sure that two-sided is unchecked. Then hold T and left click anywhere in the material graph to create a texture sample node. Then right click this node and select convert to parameter. Name this parameter main texture. You can set the default value of this main texture in the details panel to be the T_Niagara_UV_debug_texture. Now right click above your main texture in the material graph and search for particle color. The reason we've added this is because we want to be able to manipulate the color and opacity of our texture directly from Niagara. To achieve this, hold M and left click in the material graph twice, creating 2 multiply nodes. Then drag both color pins into the top multiply and both alpha pins into the bottom multiply. And finally, drag the top multiply node into the emissive color pin of your master node and the bottom one into its opacity pin. Now save this material and go back to your materials directory. Let's right click the material we created and select the Create Material Instance option. Name this material instance mi_ss_add_ground_rune. Double click this material instance, then in the details panel, enable the main texture parameter override and set the texture to be that of our rune. Now save and go back to the Niagara system editor. We can now assign our mesh renderer's material to be the ground rune material we just created. After doing so, press the plus button in the emitter update stage to add a module named Spawn Burst Instantaneous. As you can see in the preview window, we now have our rune on the ground plane. Now in the timeline panel, drag the green track of the rune emitter to be 14 seconds long, then right click and hold shift near the 14 seconds mark to snap to it. Press the right bracket button, setting the playback to end at this time. Then do the same near the 0 second mark, and press the left bracket button to set the playback start mark. Now if you press play, you'll see that our rune stays static. To add the fading in and out effects we need for our build up and dissipation stages, we'll add a module to our particle update stage named Scale Color. Here we disable Scale RGB and then press the drop down arrow to the right of Scale Alpha. We'll search and select for the Float from Curve function. This will allow us to set the opacity of our emitter directly from this curve. Our emitter's lifetime will start when the x-axis is 0, and it will end when it reaches 1, sampling opacity values from the y-axis during this period. Now if we press play in our timeline, we can see that our rune fades away over time. During the effect overview, we stated that the rune fades in during the first second of the effect, and then fades out between the 12th and 13th seconds. To implement this, press the Open in Curves panel button, drag our first key value to 0, and then press the middle mouse button on the line to create another key. Select this key and then set its time to be at 1 over 14, then set its value to be 0.04. Now add another key, set its time to be 12 over 14, and its value to be 0.04 again. This way our value stays consistent between these two time periods. Finally, select the final key in our curve and set its time to be 13 over 14. If we press play in our timeline panel, we can see that our rune fades in and out as we wanted. To demonstrate another useful feature of curve functions, I'll press F to bring all my keys into view, then left click and drag over them to select the keys. Right clicking anywhere in the curves panel will open up a context menu. This has multiple useful utilities, including different types of interpolation functions to apply to the keys. If you've used any other sequencing tools, such as Premiere Pro or After Effects, then you'll be familiar with this feature. We won't be using this for our rune emitter, but we will be using these features later on. Now that we've animated our rune, we're going to create two more user exposed parameters, bloat and delinear color. We can use these to scale and colorize our effect on a per instance basis. Name these parameters scale and color 01, then select the blue system node to set their default values. I'll set my scale to 1 and the color to 1141. The reason that we can set our color values to be greater than 1 is because our rune material is unlit and thus utilizes emission to render out its color. This allows us to increase the glow of our effect by simply increasing these RGB values. To set our rune's color, navigate to the initialized particle module of our emitter and set its color mode to direct. Then drag our color 01 parameter into this attribute. As you can see in the preview panel, our effect is now rendering the color which we have set. To set its scale, change the mesh scale mode to non-uniform. This option lets you specify different scale values for each axis of the mesh. Select the drop-down arrow on the right and search for multiply vector by float. This sets the mesh's scale to the result of the vector multiplied by this float. Set the z-axis value to 0 and then drag our scale parameter into the float multiplier attribute. Now save, go back to the level editor and drag your newly created Niagara system into the level. Since we set our custom parameters in the user exposed section, we can override them directly in the details panel. For example, if we set the scale to 10, our rune size scales as expected. However, you'll notice that if we try to move our system around, it doesn't update straight away. This is because we need to set our emitter's local space flag to true. This way, the particles rendered through our emitter are relative to the emitter's origin rather than to the world. Going back to our level editor, we can now freely move our rune around in real time. Before we begin creating the next emitter in our effect, let's take a quick look at the Niagara debugger. To open this up, select the Tools menu, then Debug, then Niagara Debugger. Enable the Debug HUD and Overview checkboxes, as well as the System filter under the Debug filters. Now set the System Debug Verbosity to Basic. Now you can clearly see where our system is, as well as some of its properties. Setting the emitter's verbosity to basic will add additional statistics about the system's emitters. In this case, showing us that we have one emitter active, which has one particle active. If we change this value to verbose, then we can see our emitter's name, whether or not it's active, and its particle count. This was mainly to show you a sneak peek of the Niagara debugger, and to let you know that it's a very powerful tool once you learn how to use it. But more on this later, as it's time to create the flame-like particles surrounding our rune. Let's go back to the Niagara system. Right-click anywhere in the system graph, select Add Emitter, then select Simple Sprite Burst. Press F2 to rename it to any underscore border particles. We'll start by setting our emitter's location to be relative to its local space by toggling this option in its property stage. As we want our particles to fade in as soon as the active region stage of our effect begins, we need to delay the time at which the emitters begin rendering our particles. To do this, navigate to the emitter's state module and enable the loop delay attribute. Then press its drop-down arrow and search for multiply by float. Drag our effect runtime parameter into the first attribute of this function and set the second to be 1 over 14. Doing this will allow us to maintain accurate effect timings when changing the running time of our effect on a per instance basis. We also want to make sure that our particles render for the remaining 13 seconds of our effect. To do this, set the loop behavior flag to infinity, then select the drop-down arrow to the right of the loop duration attribute and search for multiply float. We'll drag our effect runtime into the first attribute and set the second to be 13 over 14. Now navigate to the emitter's initialized particle module and set the same values for its lifetime attribute. As we want our particles to spawn with different widths and heights, we'll set the sprite size mode to be random non-uniform. This function gets called when our particles are spawned into the game world, and sets their size to be some value within the minimum and maximum values that we have set. As we want our entire effect to be scalable on a per instance basis, we need to multiply this minimum and maximum by our scale parameter. To do this, press the drop down arrow to the right of both the minimum and maximum and search for multiply vector2d by float. Now drag the scale parameter into both float attributes. I'm going to set my particles x values, which represent their width, to range between 0.25 and 0.75. Then their y values, which represent their height, to range between 5 and 20. Now, as we want our particles to spawn in a ring around our rune, we need to add a shape location module to our particle spawn stage. By default, the shape being used is set to a sphere. We want to change this to a ring. As we want our ring to scale with our effect, select the drop-down arrow to the right of the ring radius and search for multiply float. Then drag the scale parameter into the first attribute and set the second to be 32. As things stand, we're only rendering a single particle. Let's change this by navigating to the Spawn Burst Instantaneous module in our emitter's update stage and setting the spawn count to 300. At this point, it'll be easier to see the state of our effect by enabling the Show Floor option in our preview scene settings. We want our particles to be randomly assigned a color between some range of colors. To do this, add another linear color user exposed parameter and name it color02. Then, select your blue system node and set your color02 parameter's default value to this emissive purple color. Now in your emitter's initialized particle module, set the color mode to be random range and drag the color01 and color02 parameters into the minimum and maximum attribute slots. The next thing we need to do is solve a problem regarding our particles' orientations. Notice how when we move our camera, our particles rotate to face it. Instead, we want our particles to always face the center of our rune. To achieve this, let's navigate to our emitter's sprite renderer, set its alignment attribute to velocity aligned, and then set the facing mode to be a custom facing vector. What this does is set the particles to always face the value which we set for the particles.spriteFacingVector attribute. In our case, we want this to be the direction vector between each particle's position and the position of the center of our rune, which is the same as the center point of our simulation. Since we don't plan to rotate our particles during our effects runtime, we can set this vector once when our particles are spawned. To do this, press the plus button in the particle spawn stage and search for set new or existing parameter. Then in the selection panel, press the plus button and search for sprite facing. Then press the drop down arrow to the right of this attribute and search for subtract vector. Drag the particle's position parameter into the first attribute slot and then drag the simulation position parameter into the second slot. Now as you can see, our particle's orientation is fixed, pointed towards the origin of our rune. Another useful feature of the sprite renderer is the pivot and UV space attribute, which determines the pivot point of the particles. In our example, we could change the pivot's V value to 1, making our particle's lowest point touch the ground rather than their center points. The next thing we'll do is animate our particles so that they fade in and out during the first and final 2 seconds of their 13 second lifetime. To do this, select the scale color module and open up the alpha curve to the curves panel. Set the first key to 0, then add 2 more keys by pressing the middle mouse button. Set the first key to be at 2 over 13 and the second key to be at 11 over 13, both with a value of 1. Then bring all our keys into view by pressing F and then hover over the first 2 keys to select them. Then, right-click to open up the context menu and select the user interpolation option. This will assign each key an animation handle, allowing us to manually create this non-linear curve for our fading in effect. And now for our fading out effect, we can select the last 2 keys, open up the context menu and select the break option. This will fade our particles out in this more organic looking manner. As you can see, our particles are now fading in and out as we expect. Now next up, we're going to add the floating particles to our effect. In order to render these particles, we're going to need a double-sided material, as players may look at these particles from all directions. To create this, let's duplicate the single-sided emitter we created earlier and rename it m_add_ds_Niagara, DS standing for double-sided. Now open it up and enable its two-sided attribute. Save it and go back to your materials directory. Right-click this new material and create a material instance, then name it and open it up. Set its texture to be that which we want our floating rune particles to have. Now do this one more time, but set its texture to be that of the streak particles. Now that we've done that, let's head into our Niagara system to create our emitters. Right-click anywhere in the system graph, select Add Emitter, and then select Empty Emitter. Rename this to any_floating_rune_particles. From our effect overview, we know that our particles are going to continuously spawn in a ring around the ground rune, moving upwards and getting smaller until they eventually disappear. In order to spawn our particles continuously rather than once at the beginning of our effect, we'll add the spawn rate module to our emitter's update stage, which will spawn as many particles as we set its spawn rate attribute to be every time our update stage is called. We'll create a user exposed float parameter to store its value. Name this parameter floating particle spawn rate and set its default value to 20 in the blue system node. Then drag it into the spawn rate attribute of our emitter's spawn rate module. As we want our floating particles to show up as soon as our effect's active stage begins and then continue spawning new particles until the end of our effect, then we need to set its lifecycle properties to match this. Fortunately, we already did this for our border particles earlier on, so we can simply copy that over to this emitter. To do that, delete the current emitter state module of our Rune particles emitter, then hold the Alt key and drag the emitter state module from our border particles emitter into the emitter update stage of our new emitter. Since we want our particles to fade in and out, we can alt drag the scale color module we created for our border particles into the particle update stage of our new emitter. We can also do this for our shape location module, as we want our particles to spawn in a ring around the rune. Next, we'll set our new emitter's renderer material to be the double-sided material instance we just created for our rune. As you can see, our particles are currently too large. To fix this, we'll navigate to our emitter's initialized particle module and set its sprite size mode attribute to random uniform, which will spawn our particles with a random size between the minimum and maximum which we set for these attributes. We also want these to scale with the size of our effect, so select the drop-down arrow for both the minimum and maximum and search for multiply float. Drag our user exposed scale parameter into the first lot of these attributes and then set the minimum to 0.5 and the maximum to 2. Since we're already in the initialized particle module, let's set our particle's color to be a random range between our color 01 and color 02 parameters. The next thing we're going to do is add movement to our particles so that they move upwards into the sky, getting smaller as they reach the end of their lifetime. Let's set their lifetime to be a random range between 1.5 and 2.5. Then add a velocity module to our particle spawn stage, which by default adds velocity to our particles in the z-axis. However, if you take a look at our effect, you'll see that our particles aren't moving. This is because we need to add a solve forces and velocity module to our particles update stage. This module tells our emitter that it needs to recalculate the position of our particle as we're trying to move it. As you can see, our particles are now moving, but as it stands, this motion looks quite robotic as all our particles are moving at the same speed. To make this movement seem more organic, let's change the velocity of our add velocity module to be a random range vector ranging from 20 to 100 in the z-axis. The last thing we need to do to achieve our desired effect is animate our rune particles so that their scale goes to zero as they reach the end of their lifetime. To do this, add a scale sprite size module to the emitter's update stage and open it in the curves panel. Drag the first key to 1 and the second key to 0. Then select both of our keys, right click and select the user interpolation option. Then select the last key's handle and make this curve. As you can see, our particles are now behaving exactly as we wanted. We've created our floating rune particles. To create our floating streak particles, simply duplicate this emitter and switch out the material that we've used for the one that we created for our streak particles. We'll also create a new linear color user parameter named streak color, and then in the blue system node, set its default value to blue. Now navigate to the initialized particle module of our new emitter and set its color mode to be direct set. Then drag our streak color parameter into this color attribute. And that's it. We've successfully created our very own shiny runes, having learned how to use some of Niagara's fundamental modules and concepts along the way. In the next chapter of this series, we're going to use Unreal Engine 5's blueprint system to spawn our effect into the game world, as well as set the values of its user exposed variables. If you want to support this in future content, please like, subscribe, and consider checking out my Patreon. Tell somebody you love them, and I'll see you in the next one.